Welcome to American TESOL Presents Free Friday Webinars. I'm Shelley Sanchez-Terro, and this is Roscoe the Pug. And we are here to present survival tips for teaching with technology. So you don't have to be like, I have to teach with technology this year. We're going to share some tips thanks to American TESOL. We are also, this is the start of the ESLTech.com course. So you can attend the webinar every Friday. It's free. But you also can get a certification for teaching with technology by American TESOL, which is also approved by many other institutes and even master's programs in the U.S. and abroad. But you have to be part of American TESOL for that. So you can find the information if you go to ESLTech.com. You can take it at your own pace. There's different types of topics, and this is the first one. So we're going to go ahead and start. These are some of the reasons why teaching with technology is quite important and why we should do it with our students. Because our world, the way that we learn languages, the way that we have customs, our norms, our values, our traditions, our learning, our communication is all influenced by technology. So if we don't help students learn how to use that technology responsibly, then we are all impacted by it. And it doesn't matter if you're the only person in the world that doesn't use a phone, which I doubt. I do go into sessions. I travel around the world. I'm in Texas today, but all over the world. I do meet a few people. Even last week when I was in Indiana, met someone who said, I'm a Luddite though. But let me tell you, even if you think you're a Luddite, you are still impacted by technology because your child, your students definitely, your nieces, your nephews, your cousins, your family, they're all impacted by technology because they do use their mobile devices to connect. They use computers to connect. They use lots of different gadgets to connect and devices. And if they don't learn how to use it responsibly, how to reflect on their online behavior, then they change our language. They change our customs. They change the way that we learn needs to be matched in the classroom. And so I really like this quote by Steve Ballmer, which focuses not on the negativity. Yes, it can be overwhelming sometimes, but really about the potential. So in this particular session, we want you to focus on integrating technology, but not integrating technology, but looking at necessarily in a way that's scary or anything, but we want you to see the potential and to look at the possibilities. A lot of the ideas that you find here are in my book, Learning to Go, but we're going to share them here. They're also in my book, The Third Equals Challenge for Teachers. There's a particular chapter that's also called Integrate Technology Effectively. And for attending this session today, you get a badge. You get the Integrate Technology badge. You can even join our badge list, which is badgelist.com/30goals. And that's free. So you can join that and you can show off your badge for attending the webinar today. So let's go into these survival tips and see. Yes, we're going to see what tips we have here. The first tip is to discover what tools your students currently use, because many of us are in different settings all over the world. We tend to have a very worldwide audience. Some of you may use cell phones. Your students may have cell phones. Some of you may work with very young learners and they have computers, or maybe they have just digital cameras. Maybe you only have a few digital cameras you can spare and you can bring into the classroom. Maybe you have a laptop. Maybe you have a tablet or something that you take in the classroom. And I know for me, that's usually the case. The technology that we have in the classroom, I bring it or the students bring it. When I do train in other schools, and I've been to about 30 countries now, I happen to be able to work with settings where they have carts of iPads and they have labs full of computers, and that's a really great situation. But I think a lot of most teachers have a situation where they don't have a lot of technology, at least in my experience. So I teach teachers, actually. Those are my students. But I also teach their students. So I do teach young learners, high school and above. And I teach their classrooms often as well. So one of the best ways you can do this is with Google Forms. And I'm going to go ahead and share a link with you on my Pearl Trees, because if you go to my Pearl Trees on teaching with technology, then what you're going to see is you're going to see a form, and it's a Google form, and it allows you, I've already started this survey for you. All you have to do is get in, make a copy, edit it, and then you can use it with your own students. So I've already started this form for you, this Google form, and it's a good way to ask students. When you're teaching with technology, just remember that you have a lot of experience. You grew up in an age where devices changed all the time, where we use things like cell phones. We used to have big cell phones that were huge like this. They're as big as Roscoe, to now where we have very small little devices, where we have tablets, where we have things like Nelly was saying inside the chat, Periscope, we can just stream live from our phones, which is quite amazing. So don't think that you don't have the tech savviness to be able to use the tool. Don't focus on it, because it doesn't really matter the tool as much as it matters the pedagogy. And when you focus on the learning and you focus on the pedagogy, you are able to concentrate and focus on what is being taught, what is being learned, and also your students' reaction and impact to it. So technology can be an accelerator, it can be an engager. It can get students wanting to be on there and wanting to learn more. And it can be a big, big motivator as well. So think of the potential again of the technology. What do I mean by that? Well, good pedagogy says that with technology, you should be able to play with it. Just like we play in the real world and we have lessons where we explore. And what do we mean by that? We mean like taking pictures. We mean things like playing, where you can play games. You can create games on a digital device where they can experiment, where they can try coding on a device. That's experimentation, because you're typing in something, you're giving a command, and you're going to see what's going to happen. So that's an experiment. Citizenship, being good to people using a device. Pedagogy is learning from your peers, something from Howard Rheingold. Collaboration, how we can work together. And I think that even here we see the power of that. We see where we get together, we are connected, and we're really able to learn the different skills and connect with each other just through this platform here, which I think is really amazing. There's also different specific things you can do with technology. So if you're here, and I want to say hi to everyone who's here. I see a few names from our 30 goals as well. So thank you so much for attending that before. And also, if you hadn't before, we'll give you, this is so you can get your badge, although I think some of you have already gotten some of the badges. But these are real things you can do with technology. You can write a blog, which is writing. It's sort of like writing an essay. You can use rubrics that are almost the same, except add a few more elements. You can do things where you can have infographics, where you create, you have data visualization. One of my favorite things to do is digital stories. I think they're powerful, and they help impact students. You can create comics with free tools. And throughout the ESL Tech course and these free webinars that you have, you'll be able to see in a couple of weeks, we're going to do one on comics. We're going to do one on posters. We're going to do one on how to use video in the classroom, how to do audio projects, how to have Creative Commons, how to do digital storytelling, how to create e-portfolios. So we'll go through all of these game-based education and all of these topics. So co-learning, you can go to peergachi.org. That talks about how we collaborate together. But there are many, many different types of digital pedagogy out there that you should be familiar with. So I'm going to type out a few. The SAMR, that's one, the SAMR model. We have connectivism. That's another one, connectivism. We have digital blooms. Digital blooms is a good one as well. We have different types of, we have TPAC, okay? So these are all things that you can find on the Pearl Trees that will really help you to begin to understand and bring your mind and your thinking of how you integrate technology in the classroom. So definitely recommend checking out those different digital pedagogies, things that really focus on that. The other person I think you should really connect with is Tim Bucky, or you can Google him at Steve Wheeler, who is my Google, my guru when it comes to teaching with technology. Steve Wheeler, he blows my mind. He talks about so many digital, he teaches, he's a university professor, and he often talks about these subjects. There's a Digital Blooms Live Binder by Kelly Tinkley. You can find it in her fantastic blog, ilearntechnology.com. It shows you different websites and digital tools and stuff, and it tells you how to do a lesson with students, which I really think is great. There's a lot of sites out there that will let you know different tools, but they don't give you specific ideas, but Kelly Tinkley's blog does. So how do we find that right tool and app? There's so many things. Let's say, okay, so think of a project right now, and you can even type it in the text box, a project that you're going to do with your students this year or even train teachers with. So it might be something like a poster project, and it doesn't have to be with technology. It can just be a project, an essay, or you can have your students write essay. So when you think about that, you can type in the text box if you want. Now it's time to find a tool or app that would be good that maybe you can integrate. Well, edshelf.com is one of the best sites to do that, because with edshelf.com, and it's gotten a better look since then, it's free, but it's a search tool. So it'll allow you to say, I have 7, 8-year-old students. We use Android tablets, and we need a free app to do coding. It'll let you look for something like, hey, I want an iOS device that is going to help my students with sketchnoting, what Peggy George mentioned in the chat box right now. How can we sketchnote on a iPad? And I want something free, and it's going to probably come up with paper 53. Peggy just put. So edshelf.com is definitely my favorite resource. And all of these apps, they are reviewed by teachers. Teachers even favorite them. You can go on there, and you can even, it uses as a curation tool where you can bookmark it as well. Graph.org is another one, and it does really, two strongest ones I recommend. One of the easiest ways to be able to integrate technology is to add a technology component to current lessons. So I had you think about something you were going to have your students do, either do create a quiz, have them take a quiz. Well, you quiz from being a paper quiz, you can make it to where it's a digital quiz where they can use their digital data. How do I get this to be on? Go ahead and use something it like Google Forms. So you just add that tech component. You're going to take a quiz, but instead I'm going to have you take it on Google Forms. Or maybe it's a poster tool. Maybe you have a big poster project, and instead you're going to have your students use Buncee, ThingLink, Canva, VisMe. I haven't put those up, but those are great ones as well. And of course, you can always think of more ways, more ideas, if you go to ideas2inspire.co.uk. If you fall in love with the tool, and I think it's okay, I think that sometimes you can have where you have a tool that you're in love with, and that's happened to me. Tools like, for example, Yak It for Kids, I love, Bunsie, Pearl Tree, all of these things that I love, a voice thread. I fall in love with tools all the time. The thing is, and I heard someone say this, and I'm not sure, it was at a conference, and I don't remember the exact person who said it, but I heard that one is called, where they say something that's like, you can date a few apps, you don't have to marry everyone, you can just date them. And I kind of like that concept of dating apps or dating tools, because there's so many free ones out there. There's literally hundreds of ones today. So I think that when you think about it, you can have where you have ideas2inspire.co.uk. They give you interesting ways to use different tools and apps you love. So if you have something like Pinterest, anything like that, try to go here and try to find ways that teachers are using them. The technology is going to fail you. Let me repeat, the technology is going to fail you. In fact, we're going to have Roscoe repeat. The technology is going to fail you, okay? It is going to be tough because learning is tough. Trying things, experimenting, even with technology, is very tough. And there are difficult situations where the internet, I'll be going and traveling back in November to Venezuela. That's where I work sometimes throughout the year, usually about 2 or 3 months out of the year now. And I really enjoy it. But when the reason I love, when I do love working in Venezuela is because it keeps me grounded. A lot of the times when I work at a university, and I've had to teach without tech, and I've had to teach where technology doesn't go well, where they filtered something that I wanted to use, they filtered Google or something. And I've even had to where I've had to be able to teach with no electricity at some point. So I've had to have a lot of difficulties when it comes to teaching with technology. And because my course does focus on technology, I have to realize that. And so there are certain things that help me. Check the technology before the lesson, 30 minutes, 15 minutes if you can, because it's nice to be able to have that kind of, hey, it worked 15 minutes. Sometimes even if you check it the day before, that doesn't guarantee it's not gonna shut down. So when it does, when something does go wrong, sometimes you can shut it down, unplug it, reboot it, Google the problem, or ask for help. How do we ask for help? Well, if I'm here and my students over here and they have the phone or something and they have another device, while I'm fixing the computer here, they can be Googling the problem, or they can be helping me try to fix the problem. And if we get our students to help us, then that can be really quite a good way to get tech support. You can have your students learn different tools. Let's say they learn VoiceThread. Let's say they learn any of the tools that you're going to use. A good project is to have them make a video tutorial to work in pairs. And when you use that tool, they'll be the experts. They're in charge of getting a visual guide, a screen tutorial made, and they're in charge of learning that tool and being that tool's expert. So that's something you can do with your students. And then when they have a project that has to do with those tools, they can help the other students, so you can have time to focus on the learning and to focus on offering help. You should always have a backup plan, which is why one of my favorite sites is Read, Write, Think. I believe it's readwritethink.org. And they have, if you go under each, most of the lesson plans, if you do the interactives, will have a PDF that comes along, and then you can simply use the paper version as well. Recently in the 30 Goals Conference, one of the teachers that was a part of it, I got to meet her in Israel. Her name is Naomi Epstein. And Naomi works with deaf students in Israel. And she wrote a lot of posts which had to deal with ways she used a computer with no internet connection, how she integrated technology with few devices, how she did this with deaf students and students with special needs. So Naomi is a great example of finding a means, finding a way for students to work with technology. And it's not because technology is the end all, know all, anything like that. It's because we need to get our students to practice using it so they use it responsibly. So when they go home and they get on Facebook or Snapchat or Vine or YouTube or Twitter or any of the tools, a Kik Messenger or WhatsApp, they know how to use that responsibly. They reflect on their behavior and they think about, hey, I'm going to send a message to many different people. I'm going to have an audience. And so it's important that I make it meaningful, that I have a meaningful connection. How do I learn everything? So it's not that I'm a guru on everything. It's because one of the best ways, there's a graphic, that an image that was tweeted around Twitter. It said, what are the best ways that you learn? And I'm not sure if this is still true, but the top one, one of the top ones, was through teaching. And also, it's because I've been connected to a personal learning network. So I'm on Twitter every day, or Facebook, or Instagram, or many of these social networks. I'm connected with other teachers, not just family, not just friends, but a lot of teachers. And when I connect with teachers on these different places, Voxer, Digo, Skype, YouTube, Google Plus, webinars, all of these places, then I'm able to learn from them. They're on my stream. So every day we read in streams. If you look at your Facebook, for example, you'll see your Facebook and that's a stream, right? So you can just scan it. You can scan your Facebook. And you can quickly look through things, and maybe that's your ritual that you'll get on, you'll look on Facebook or Instagram or your email or something. And I see my feed is filled with ideas and thoughts from other teachers. So that's why I'm able to be able to present and teach you so much, because I learn from so many. And you can do that too if you connect with other teachers. The other important thing is to partner with parents. If the parent likes you, if you win the parent over, even if you think the parent is difficult, and you know, some parents are going to be difficult because they love their kids, and they're always going to be their kid's champion. So it's with us. If somebody said, oh, even if they said Roscoe is terrible, or if somebody told you that, you know, someone that you love very deeply is terrible or anything like that, you would be very offended by that. And so you would want to stick up for them. Same thing with parents. So we got to give parents leverage, get to partner with them, say something good at the beginning that we like about the student. We can do that through technology. We can send emails quite quickly. We can use things like Mind 101 or Selly, or many different apps to be able to connect with parents and to be able to share with them and to keep them updated on their children. If the parent likes you, you'll probably have less problems from the student the rest of the year. But I can guarantee you that if you don't partner with the parents, then you're going to have a very hard time, because if a parent's always talking about you and doesn't support you, then the child is going to disrespect you. So it's important that we do make that connection with all of the parents. And I know that's very difficult. So there's more tips. If you go to shellyterrell.com/survival tips, you're going to find a lot of things, including partnering with parents, which is another webinar. Make sure that students and parents sign an acceptable or responsible use policy. Sometimes it's called a digital use policy. It looks a lot like that. It's a list, a code of conduct of what you expect out of their behavior online, how to be a digital citizen. We'll talk more about that later. But it's also good because they see the consequences. They need to know the consequences. What's going to happen? Oh, you're going to get the cell phone taken away, or we're going to lose that privilege as a class. You get to detail and outline it. You also get to have a sharing policy. Parents get to say, yes, you can share my child's voice. Yes, you can share their picture. Yes, you can put them in videos. And if you can't, well, that's okay, because then you get to figure out the technologies where it hides the student's voice. Make sure that you cover digital literacy and citizenship daily. It's not separate from the curriculum, but it's something that we ask our students every day. We publish their work and we have them ask themselves, how will this digital act impact society? How will this like? How will this publishing? How will this message that I made, this infographic, how is it going to impact those around me? Is this going to pollute the world digitally? Am I going to send something digitally on the stream that is going to be negative, make someone feel down? And do I want to be responsible for that feeling? Do I want to be responsible for my friends or peers or my parents or my grandparents feeling bad by this? And so these are things that, you know, your students, it's an ethical code. It's them having ethics. And there are going to be questionable things. There's going to be some times when they want to be an activist in protest, and that's going to accept some people. So it's good for them to be able to decide that they're comfortable with these, what they publish. And think about the long-term impacts. So how do you manage all this? Well, learning stations, group work, and facilitate. Those are all part of the webinars we've done. Activity logs is one that I've done with my students. So they have to say the time, the date, every time they go into a station, if they go to the technology station, if the cell phones, the pod, whatever station they go to, they have to fill in the time. They have to fill in the date. They have to sign in their name. They have to say what they did. And there's a station leader. There's another student that's responsible. There's usually two. Each week, that changes, so everyone knows how to be responsible. Because if anything happens where it's on the computer and we shared it, then we can go back to the log and we can say, well, you were on the log at this time. Calendars as well. You can have where the students know, okay, on Monday, that's when I'm going to get my project. On Friday, that's when we present the project. Or on Monday, that's when I say, Catherine Tissering, Katie Tissering, or Nellie Deutsch are both responsible for our reading station. And next week, it's going to be Peggy and Sheila who are responsible for the game station, and so forth and so forth. So there's a lot of things that you can rotate. You see how your students are very much at the center. They're responsible for taking care of each other, taking care of the community, and for what they post and how they take care of things. There's a system called the yellow, blue, red cup system. I learned it from the organizedclassroom.blog. If you have a yellow cup on top, so you have a stack of cups, the yellow one says, we're okay, sunny and bright, all right. Blue is, okay, we're finished, we're through, what are we gonna do? Red is for, help, we have a problem. You can wear a scarf on your neck, and that means I'm helping someone else. If the scarf is off, then they know they can call on you. Give digital badges, like you're getting a badge today. And have fun with it, because if you're having fun, if you're relaxed, if you're continuing with the learning and you're focusing on it, then your students are going to have fun as well. You can encourage play with the digital sandbox. That's another lesson, but you can find my activity there if you go to bit.ly/digisandbox. I make it with Symbaloo. Basically, I give them a bunch of tools that I think are good for the classroom, and then they can create with them. So at the end of all of this, realize that working with technology is going to be tough. You're going to run into snafus. You're going to have problems. But it's just a tool. It's just like I think Nellie said, wood, hardware. It does powerful things, but it's powerful when we use it powerfully, and we can use it in ways that are motivating, where we spread kindness, where we solve problems, where we learn to think, where we're creative. We can get our students to do that, but you have to get the students to do that. Nobody else can get them, just you, because you're in charge of your classroom. And so it's great because you're the person who's here today, so obviously you very much care about this, and you're the one who's going to be able to help your students a lot. But it's also very powerful in that it can damage. And there's a lot of damage that's been out there. There's sexting and cyberbullying and all of this. So it's great that you're here today and you're learning about this on your own time, because we can stop that. And the way we stop that is by facilitating and guiding and motivating our students to do positive, powerful things with their technology use. You can find a lot of these if you go to my Pearl Trees. So I'll go ahead and get that for you. But thank you so much for coming today. You can find me at a lot of social networks. I'm Shelly Terrell or Shell Terrell. The other thing that I'm going to do is I am going to get you this link to the Pearl Trees. And make sure that you go to the ESLTech.com. You can check it up, check it out, see what we're doing, and see how you can get your certification. Or you can see us next week. We're free every week. Friday, so about this time, and you can bring a friend along as well. So we're gonna say bye to the loose. Thank you very much.